Hello dear students, today we are going to start class 10th history chapter 3 nationalism in India part 3. Students, in this part we will cover introduction towards civil disobedience movement, demand for Purna Swaraj, economic depression 1930, the Simon Commission, the Salt March, Gandhi-Irwin Pact. Towards civil disobedience movement. Students, before starting today's content, let us recall the contents we discussed in previous part so that it will be easy for you to understand the further contents. Students, as we have seen, Gandhiji had launched different movements in India to protest against Britishers. All the movements were based on two basic principles. Those were truth and non-violence. Gandhiji had launched different movements, and that period is known as Gandhian era. Students, as we have seen in previous part, Gandhiji launched non-cooperation movement. In his famous book Hind Swaraj, Mahatma Gandhi declared that British rule was established in India with the cooperation of Indians and had survived only because of this cooperation. If Indians refused to cooperate, British rule in India would collapse within a year and Swaraj would come. So this was the expectation of Gandhiji, that if we will not cooperate with Britishers, they will leave our country. Gandhiji proposed that the movement should unfold in stages. It should begin with the surrender of titles and the government awarded and a boycott of civil services, army, police, courts and legislative councils, schools and foreign goods. Then in case the government used suppression, a full civil disobedience campaign would be launched. Through the summer of 1920, Mahatma Gandhi and Shaukat Ali toured extensively mobilizing popular support for the movement. Students, Shaukat Ali, let us remind, Shaukat Ali and Muhammad Ali started Khilafat movement, and later the Khilafat movement and non-cooperation movement united because the enemy was common for the Hindus and Muslims. Students, some of the leaders in Congress party, they were against the non-cooperation. Finally, at the Congress session at Nagpur in December 1920, a compromise was worked out and the non-cooperation program was adopted. Students, as we have seen, different people, they joined the movement with different expectations. Various social groups which joined the non-cooperation movement, we have seen in that middle class people in the towns consisted of students, teachers and lawyers responded to the clarion call of non-cooperation as a passport to freedom from the foreign rule. Students, we have also seen peasants and tribal people in various places. Peasants and tribals also participated in the movement. The movement was launched against talukdars and landlords for them. Students, non-cooperation movement meant for peasants that they would not be required to pay land dues, that is land revenue, and the land they were cultivating would be distributed among them when the colonial government began forcing the tribal people to contribute begar for road building, they revolted. So in this way, we have also seen the expectations of peasants and tribal people. Now, plantation workers also joined the movement. They participated in the movement with the hope that they would be free to move in and out of the confined space in which they had been enclosed. Students, as we discussed, that those people, those they were working in tea gardens, they were not allowed to move anywhere or to go to their homes. They were forced to live in that workplace. So they wanted the freedom of movement. They hoped that Gandhi Raj was coming and everyone would be given land in their own villages. So in this way, everyone joined the movement with different hopes and aspirations. Towards civil disobedience movement. Students, formation of Swaraj Party. Before this, once I want to remind you that one incident had taken place, that was Chauri Chaura incident. In that incident, a peaceful demonstration in bazaar turned into a violent clash with the police. Hearing of the incident, Mahatma Gandhi called a halt to the non-cooperation movement. After this, Gandhiji became disappointed. In February 1922, Gandhiji decided to withdraw the non-cooperation movement. He felt the movement was turning violent in many places and satyagrahis needed to be properly trained before they would be ready for mass struggles. And wanted to participate. Within the Congress, some leaders were by now tried of mass struggle and wanted to participate in elections to the provincial council that had been set up by Government of India Act of 1919. They felt it was important to oppose British policies within the councils, argue for reform and also demonstrate that these councils were not truly democratic. As there was no equality, Siya Das and Motilal Nehru formed the Swaraj Party within the Congress to argue for a return to council politics. But younger leaders like Jawaharlal Nehru and Subhash Chandra Bose pressed for more radical mass agitation and full independence. Economic depression. Students, in such a situation of internal debate and dissension, two factors again shaped Indian politics towards the late 1920s. The first was the effect of the worldwide economic depression. Agricultural prices began to fall from 1926 and collapsed after 1930. As the demand for agricultural goods fell and exports declined, the peasants found it difficult to sell their harvest and pay their revenue. By 1930, the countryside was in turmoil. Students, as the prices fell, farmers were not able to make profit. Even their earnings became very less. It was very difficult for them to pay the tax to the government. So it was a very critical time for the peasants. By 50%, the prices fell down. Peasants and farmers were the most affected because of this. Let us remind, the Great Depression of Indian economy occurred during 1929. This had a very strong impact when India was under British Raj. When the international prices of wheat came down, wheat in India was also affected as the prices fell down by 50%. Peasants and farmers were the most affected. As peasants and farmers, they were dependent on the agricultural production. It was the source of earning for them. But as the prices fell down, they faced great loss and they were not able to pay the revenue to the government. So they were most affected. The Simon Commission. Against this background, the new Tory government in Britain constituted a statutory commission under Sir John Simon. Set up in response to the nationalist movement, the commission was to look into the functioning of the constitutional system in India and suggest changes. The problem was that the commission did not have a single Indian member. They were all Britishers. Students, when the Simon Commission arrived in India in 1928, it was greeted with the slogan, "Go back, Simon." All parties, including the Congress and the Muslim League, participated in the demonstrations. In an effort to win them over, the Viceroy Lord Irwin announced in October 1929 a vague offer of dominion status for India in an unspecified future and a roundtable conference to discuss a future constitution. This did not satisfy the Congress leaders because they were not in the favor of dominion status. Let us once again see, when the Simon Commission arrived in India in 1928, it was greeted with the slogan, "Go back, Simon." All parties, including the Congress and the Muslim League, participated in the demonstrations. In an effort to win them over, the Viceroy Lord Irwin announced in October 1929 a vague offer of dominion status for India in an unspecified future, future, and a roundtable conference to discuss the future constitution. This did not satisfy the Congress leaders. Students, as India wanted full freedom, but dominion status was offered by the Britishers to Indian people. So it was disliked by the Congress leaders because they wanted the Purna Swaraj or full independence. Demand for Purna Swaraj. The radicals within the Congress, led by Jawaharlal Nehru, Subhash Chandra Bose, became more assertive and liberals. They were more assertive in the party. The liberals and moderates who were proposing a constitutional system within the framework of British dominion, gradually lost their influence. In December 1929, under the presidency of Jawaharlal Nehru, the Lahore Congress formalized the demand of Purna Swaraj, or full independence for India. It was declared that 26 January 1930 would be celebrated as the Independence Day, when people were to take a pledge for struggle for complete independence. As radicals, they were not ready to accept the dominion status. They demanded Purna Swaraj, and students, in the summer 1929, under the presidency of Jawaharlal Nehru, the Lahore Congress formalized the demand of Purna Swaraj, or full independence. And they declared that 26 January would be celebrated as the Independence Day. So in this way, the Congress leaders, they demanded the Purna Swaraj. They were not in the favor of dominion status. The Salt March and the Civil Disobedience Movement. Students, Mahatma Gandhi found in salt a powerful symbol that could unite the nation. On 31 January 1930, he sent a letter to Viceroy Irwin, stating 11 demands. Some of these were of general interest, others were specified demands of different classes, from industrialists, peasants. The idea was to make the demands wide-ranging so that all classes within Indian society could identify with them, and everyone could be brought together in a united campaign. The most stirring of all was the demand to abolish the salt tax. Salt was something consumed by the rich and the poor alike, and it was one of the most essential items of food. The tax on salt and the government monopoly over its production. Mahatma Gandhi revealed the most oppressive phase of British rule, as it was consumed by everyone, but government imposed high tax on salt, so it was very difficult for the common people to afford it. Mahatma Gandhi's letter was, in a way, an ultimatum of the demands. If the demands were not fulfilled by 11th March, the letter stated the Congress would launch a civil disobedience campaign. Irwin was unwilling to negotiate, so Mahatma Gandhi started his famous Salt March, accompanied by 78 of his trusted volunteers. The march was over 240 miles from Gandhiji's ashram in Sabarmati to Gujarati coastal town of Dandi. The volunteers walked for 24 days, about 10 miles a day. Thousands came to hear Mahatma Gandhi wherever he stopped, and he told them what he meant by Swaraj and urged them to peacefully defy the British. On 6 April, he reached Dandi and ceremonially violated the law, manufacturing salt by boiling sea water. So in this way, the Dandi March had taken place. Now students, civil disobedience movement was different from the non-cooperation movement. People were now asked not only to refuse cooperation with the British as they had done in 1921-22, but also to break colonial laws. Students, this movement was different than the non-cooperation movement in that Gandhiji said to the people not to cooperate with Britishers. But this movement was different than that, in that the people were now asked not only to refuse cooperation with the British, they should break the rules made by the Britishers. Gandhiji's salt march was undoubtedly a symbol to unite the nation, because all classes of Indian society came together as a united campaign. Mahatma Gandhi broke the salt law with the march from Sabarmati to Dandi. Thousands others in different parts of the country broke the salt law, manufactured salt and demonstrated in front of the government salt factories. As the movement spread, foreign cloth was boycotted and liquor shops were picketed. Peasants refused to pay revenue and chowkidari taxes. Village officials resigned. In many places, forest people violated forest laws, going into resort forest to collect wood and graze cattle. As students, Britishers, they made many restrictions on the people. People, they had to pay heavy taxes to the Britishers. They made the forest laws that made the life of forest dwellers miserable. So they started breaking these rules and regulations made by the Britishers. In this way, they supported the civil disobedience movement. Students, worried by developments, the colonial government began arresting Congress leaders one by one. This led to violent clashes in many places. When Abdul Ghaffar Khan, a devout disciple of Mahatma Gandhi, was arrested in April 1930, angry crowds demonstrated in the streets of Peshawar, facing armed cars and police firing. Many were killed. A month later, when Mahatma Gandhi himself was arrested, industrial workers in Sholapur attacked police posts, municipal buildings, law courts, and railway stations. All structures that symbolize British rule, they destroyed. A frightened government responded with a policy of brutal repression. Peaceful satyagrahis were attacked, women and children were beaten, and about 1 lakh people were arrested. So in this way, government was suppressing the movement and people were taking active part. In such a situation, Mahatma Gandhi once again decided to call off the movement and entered into a pact with Irwin on 5th March 1931. Which is known as Gandhi-Irwin Pact. By this Gandhi-Irwin Pact, Gandhiji consented to participate in a roundtable conference in London, and the government agreed to release the political prisoners. In December 1931, Gandhiji went to London for the conference, but the negotiations broke down and he returned disappointed. Back in India, he discovered that government had begun a new cycle of repression. Ghaffar Khan and Jawaharlal Nehru were both in jail, as leaders were arrested and they were put in jail. The Congress had been declared illegal, and series of measures had been imposed to prevent meetings, demonstrations, and boycotts. With great apprehension, Mahatma Gandhi relaunched the civil disobedience movement. For over a year, the movement continued, but by 1934, it lost its momentum. So in this way, sorry students, it should be DHI after Gandhi, it should not be there. That is Gandhi-Irwin Pact. Gandhi-Irwin Pact and the end of the movement. So in this way we have seen the Gandhi-Irwin Pact and the end of the movement. Reasons to launch the civil disobedience movement. Students, as we have discussed, different reasons to launch civil disobedience movement. Let us recall what we discussed as a reason to civil disobedience movement. That was economic depression of 1930, arrival of Simon Commission without any Indian representative, vague offer of dominion status by British failed to satisfy Indians, decisions taken in Lahore session of the Congress in 1929, there they had taken the pledge, that is for Purna Swaraj, tax on salt by Britishers. So these are the reasons because of that Gandhiji launched civil disobedience movement. Test your progress. After the explanation, let us see some questions here. Why did Gandhiji launch the civil disobedience movement? Explain any three reasons. Why did Mahatma Gandhi find salt a powerful symbol that could unite the nation? Explain. Which were the two types of demands mentioned by Gandhiji in his letter to Viceroy? Even on 31st January 1930, why was abolition of salt tax most strong demand? What was Gandhi-Irwin Pact? So students, these are some questions. I hope you can easily do this. Thank you.